Starlight, star bright, first star I see tonight. I wish I might have the wish I make tonight.
Sometimes the stars are in alignment when it comes to a project or an artistic endeavor. And that's definitely true of Pinocchio.
Pinocchio was not only the apex of the art form, but also that time, that perfect moment, when all the people, all the artists, all the musicians were together with a great artistic leader. And that only happens once in a lifetime.
Pinocchio is a unique film because it followed Snow White, and you can see the confidence that the crew had after a huge hit like Snow White. They just rolled up their sleeves and said, let's just see what we can do with the next one.
I think there are lots of reasons why so many people list it as their favorite film. Partly, it is the whole richness of the look of the film. It is just one of the most beautiful films that have ever been made, quite simply.
As ravishing as it is, I think its most glorious achievement is the risk they're taking with story, with theme, and even with character.
Basically, Pinocchio is the ultimate expression of what is possible in the craft of the animated film.
In the history of Disney animation, Pinocchio is a very, very, very important film. It was their second feature. It was the one just after Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. And that was a huge, rousing success.
People forget that Snow White was the Titanic of its day. It was a mega blockbuster.
The first feature-length animated film that anyone had ever seen on screen. So what could Disney do better than that?
Bambi, of course, was the one that had the number two number on it, but Walt wasn't sure of it yet. He didn't know how to make the picture. So he said, well, Pinocchio is one we know how to do.
Pinocchio just seemed to have a really interesting story that offered so many possibilities for things that hadn't been done before in animation.
The original story was written by a journalist and writer who lived in Florence in Italy. His name was Carlo Lorenzini. He was better known as Carlo Collodi. It began as a serial, rather like Dickens' stories were told, serialized week by week in what was the first journal for children published in Italy. It's a book about mischief, moral and improving stories about what you need to do if you're going to be a really good boy or a really good girl.
I think what remains durable about Pinocchio, certainly the most accessible, is this wild sense of invention and grotesque sense of adventure that Collodi has. But it comes mixed with some of the most cruel and vicious sort of moralizing centered around what it takes for this puppet to earn his right to becoming a real boy.
The moment that the work started on the film, it proved problematical.
We were pretty cocky coming off of Snow White. We thought we could just sit down and do another feature. We start working on sequences that were in the middle of the picture. Walt looked at it and he says, it's not working right.
What has to be remembered is that the character created by Carlo Collodi is essentially a bad boy.
He was brash, he was cocky, he was kind of unlikable. He was a troublemaker. Walt didn't like that as he was shaping up, so he changed him.
Disney began to realize that this little wooden character was really not very sympathetic, partly because he was drawn in the way that he was drawn.
They had started out doing some animation based on model sheets that really showed a Pinocchio that looked like a puppet, like really something that you would carve out of wood, very geometric shapes, very wooden looking. And Walt just didn't care for it. And he said, it just doesn't look alive and I don't see the appeal.
He was so concerned about it that he actually halted production. Production stopped and they had to decide what to do, how to take the matter forward.
They were thinking in terms of a puppet all the time, naturally, because he was a puppet. And I was very critical of what they had.
So I did a little test scene where Pinocchio had the donkey ears and a tail, and he was down on the sea bottom. And he knocked on the shell of this clam and asked him if he had any idea where he could find Monster of the Whale. And I handle it not thinking of so much as a puppet as just a little boy. Walt liked it, so that became the model. And it's still refined a little bit more later, but the idea.
This is a matter of not just changing the character's design, but changing the character's behavior so that his status as a puppet was minimized.
Pinocchio changed internally by not being cocky or arrogant or being a wise guy. He actually became a really sweet, innocent little boy.
A real boy!
It was around that same time that they decided to use the cricket. The talking cricket in the book shows up once. Pinocchio kills it by throwing a hammer at it because he's annoyed because it's giving him advice. And then it shows up again as a ghost later on.
What Disney saw in this character, and goodness knows this is a testimony to Disney's sheer inventiveness, was that it could contain the kernel of something that might make this story work.
Walt had felt that there was not enough warmth, there's not enough friendship. There's no love in the story, really. So that's where he used Jiminy Cricket.
He ended up being the heart of the story instead of getting squashed with a mallet like he did in the original Collodi version.
This moralizing little character was actually made into a sidekick, a friend, a partner to Pinocchio.
And more he comes to dominate the picture.
Very contemporary American wisecracking character.
Hey, Blubbermouth, open up. I gotta get in there.
And it's that constant humor of Jiminy's and that constant ability to deflate a serious situation.
The sunlight.
Add a little spin.
Or more privacy than a goldfish.
Or just a little dollop of humor at a moment that might otherwise not be funny that makes the film work as a whole.
It could be worse. Be cheerful, like me.
The humor in Pinocchio is just timeless.
Screwball in a corner pocket.
It's just as funny today as it would have been back then. You look at any movie from the 30s, 40s, very few hold up without being a little dated, a little corny. Pinocchio isn't.
Close your eyes. What do you see?
Nothing.
Open them. Now what do you see?
Spots.
Ha-ha!
A lot of the film has a kind of thread of irony running under it. You know, they had some pretty clever story people and some pretty clever music people working on this. So even though Honest John sings, "Hi,
diddle-dee-dee, a night is life for me,"
he's doing it to hoodwink Pinocchio. And that's a sense of irony. Jiminy Cricket has a line which I love after Pinocchio is successful as an actor on the stage.
What does an actor want with a conscience anyway?
The fact of the matter is, there's all sorts of these ironies going through it. Stromboli is another great example.
Watch this.
He's counting all of his money. He encounters a slug. He starts to curse. He goes,
"For you, my little Pinocchio."
Like he's bestowing a great gift on him.
For me?
And it's contrasted with Pinocchio's innocence. All of the characters have that kind of richness to them, and the storytelling has that kind of richness to it. I mean, you already know if they're gonna go someplace called Pleasure Island, that's gonna be bad news.
Look at yourself. Smoke. Playing poo. No!
Pinocchio's about temptation. We all are tempted every day. Do we do the right thing or do we do the wrong thing?
Where do you suppose all the kids went to, Lampwick?
Not around here somewhere. What do you care?
So we all can watch Pinocchio, whether you're 5 or 55 or 105, and go, "I wonder what I would do in that situation. It's so hard to be good."
My nose! What's happened?
Perhaps you haven't been telling the truth, Pinocchio.
On the one hand, Pinocchio is very faithful to the original stories. On the other hand, Disney lightened it up and made it more palatable to an American audience. But it does retain those dark fairy tale origins, where really bad things can happen to you if you don't follow the rules or don't have a conscience. Things can go wrong. In order to illustrate that, Disney has to show it to you in all of its horror in some cases.
Most of Walt's early films, as wonderful as they are to look at, definitely had the dark side to them. Snow White and the Queen, you know, asking for Snow White's heart to be brought to her in a box. I mean, how horrific is that?
In Pinocchio, it is heightened to this extraordinary degree because here you have a child. a child who is a true innocent. He's a child and a puppet at the same time. He doesn't understand the threat that these sinister characters present to him.
Allergic?
Yes, and there is only one cure.
Pinocchio's life, existence, future is constantly under threat, constantly menaced. Menace is constantly creeping at the edges of every scene. It's an extraordinarily disturbing and emotionally moving film.
Some story things went up and I go, well, that's really unusual by modern standards. But you're willing to forgive all that because of the kind of masterwork that the whole thing is.
Years and years ago, I talked to Frank Thomas about the movie. And of course, he had a great time working on it and thinks it's a masterpiece. One of the story points that he didn't think was resolved is in the sequence where Pinocchio makes it back home to find out that his father is gone and Figaro is gone and Cleo is gone. And how will they find out where his father is? And Frank says, I remember he was still very upset about it. And then out of all things, Frank would go, the blue fairy in shape of a dove comes down, you know, and drops this note to inform Pinocchio where the father is.
I understand that there are differing opinions about how effective the story is. I think it's important to remember that the book was written episodically. It was written for publication in a periodical, so it came out in little bits and pieces and then was put together into a book.
This is a story structure which is quite unlike anything which Disney had ever done before.
The episodic thread of it allows you to give a huge amount of scope to the film just by all of these different places that Pinocchio and Jiminy have to go.
Come, the coach departs at midnight.
I think that the way it has been organized and arranged, it's a great story. For me, it serves as a springboard for an exploration of wonderful things that can be accomplished in animation.
Oh, Figaro. I forgot to open the window.
What I love about Pinocchio are the characters. I think that they really are by far the strongest cast of characters in any feature they've done because they all have such teeth to them.
You are sensational.
You mean I'm good?
I think that's one thing the film benefits from by the fact that it is episodic. You've got each of these set pieces for these marvelous, rich characters to come and interact with Pinocchio and Jiminy. And that really gives each of these animators the opportunity to make each of their characters really, really strong.
The whole thrust of what the Disney studio did in the 1930s had to do with personality animation, but that is the heart of the art. Creating these convincing personalities through the way the characters move is a lot of what the stories were all about, because the story grows out of what you can most effectively do with the characters.
When Walt Disney first started in the animation business, his films were based very largely on fantasy. They were just pencil drawings that were brought to life with very sketchy backgrounds. They were very fantastic in the sense that these characters could do anything.
If you look at the animation that preceded Pinocchio, all of them were great experiments. All of them were really amazing achievements, whether it was in the short films and the silly symphonies or animation to music or whether it was the push for personality animation. Everything was adding to the flavor of what was great animation. And in Pinocchio, everything clicked.
That settles it.
There's been a lot of talk in recent years about the nine old men, who were the nine artists who were pretty much the mainstay of the animation department for a lot of years. At the time we're talking about here, in the late 1930s, the nine old men were still sort of the nine young whippersnappers. And the guys who actually were the mainstays of the animation department then were people like Norm Ferguson, Fred Moore, people who had actually created the whole aesthetic of Disney animation during the 1930s.
Two of the stars on the animation staff at the studio at this time were Bill Tytla and Art Babbitt, who had really absorbed all the lessons of the 1930s at the studio and, in fact, were the stars that the nine old men looked up to.
Bill Tytla was, in the estimation of a lot of people, one of the greatest animators who ever lived. One of the things that he was really known for was his animation of really strong, powerful, forceful characters. I think he may be best known today for animating Chernabog in Night on Bald Mountain. So it's not too surprising to find him doing Stromboli.
Quiet! Shut up! Before I knock you silly!
I just love the way Stromboli rocks the room. He just has such weight and power and comedy.
Introducing the only marionette who can sing and dance absolutely without the aids of a string.
And then you had somebody like Art Babbitt, who butted heads with Walt. Different artistic opinions, probably. Was a great animator, though. Did Country Cousin in the Academy Award-winning short film. Beautiful, beautiful animation. Had done the Queen in Snow White.
Art Babbitt's favorite performance that he did in animation was Geppetto. He really felt Geppetto was the best thing he had done, and he had done some marvelous things before that.
Fred Moore had been one of the major forces in the animation department in the 1930s, and he had a real knack with appealing cute characters. So he really had done a lot to establish the look of a number of Disney characters during the 1930s. He is starting to recede a little bit at the time of Pinocchio. And his main contribution in the finished film is the animation of Lampwick. And in fact, Lampwick is a little bit of a self-caricature. He looks a little like Fred Moore.
Yeah, sure.
With Pinocchio, the balance starts to shift a little bit. And you get less and less of the people who had been prominent in the 30s, and more of these younger artists who were in the process of becoming the nine old men.
Here was the birth of something. Several of the great animators beginning what was to be their lifetime career of work in the Disney studio.
One thing that was really great about Pinocchio was the casting of the animators on their particular roles. Milt Kahl kind of locked Pinocchio as a character in terms of his design, in terms of how he was handled. Frank Thomas, Ollie Johnston, and others also handled the character in specific sequences. One of the things Frank probably doesn't get a lot of credit for is animating Pinocchio as a marionette before he comes to life, with Geppetto controlling him, and you see the kind of distorted image in Cleo's goldfish bowl.
From an animation standpoint, that was very challenging to try to get this to work. There's no way you could shoot live action of it to study. You just had to make it up out of your own head.
But it feels like wood clattering on the floor. It's the perfect tour de force piece of physicalized animation. Ollie Johnston got to handle Pinocchio when he's telling the big lie to the blue fairy, and his nose is growing and gets a bird's nest on it.
Ward Kimball, one of the great Disney animators, had worked very hard on a sequence for Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
I spent 8 months on it. Was all cleaned up and ready to be inked and painted. Walt sensed it stalled the plot at that point. So he called me to his office and he said, Ward, I hate to say this, but I'm going to have to take out this soup sequence. Of course, I was crestfallen. But right away he came in, he says, but I've got a little character in our next picture, and we're going to call him Jiminy Cricket, and I'd like to have you be the animation supervisor on this. My first impression of him was this ugly insect. And I said, how can that guy carry the picture? I said, my only answer to this is I've got to make him look funny. Well, Walt really didn't want a clown-looking cricket. As he put it, make him cute, Kimball.
And the character changed and morphed, and so he became the little blue man or the little green man, or he was this little man without any ears, until it became a character which really we only know is a cricket because we're told it's a cricket.
Eric Larson's tour de force in this film was Figaro, the cat. He gave Figaro the personality of a little spoiled kid. Probably his most famous scene is when Geppetto's telling Figaro not to eat his dinner before Pinocchio comes home, and he just kind of goes into that little huff.
The This is where we cross from realism into fantasy, in my opinion. When we take an animal like Figaro, move him around as a kitten would move around. You don't take any liberties with that kind of action. But now you inject into him the personality of this young kid who is used to having everything he wanted.
You can just empathize with that little character, and for such a lovely little guy, he's always frustrated, angry, jealous. You can just riff off all these things that make him so human.
It probably was Eric Larson's best work, you know. When you click with a character and it's really alive on the screen, it's there forever.
Aw, Figaro.
This is such a labor-intensive art form that when you had a major character who occupied a lot of screen time in the film, what would happen would be that one particular animator would supervise that character, but couldn't possibly have done all of the animation of the character. So in the case of Honest John, for example, Norm Ferguson, one of the all-time great Disney animators, he supervised the unit that did Honest John.
Now let me see.
That meant he did some of the animation himself, but he would also delegate and supervise other people, one of whom was John Lounsbery.
Why, he's a natural-born actor, eh, Gideon?
Again and again, the artists who worked on this film set their own future careers. John Lounsbery went on to create Joe and Tony, the restaurateurs in Lady and the Tramp. Again, another double act.
One of the pleasures of studying a film like Pinocchio over and over again is that you learn to distinguish the styles of the major animators. Now, when you get into that pool hall on Pleasure Island, that is Freddie Moore doing Lampwick. It is Milt Kahl doing Pinocchio. And it's Ward Kimball doing the cricket. And there is just so much pleasure in watching these three masters play off each other in that sequence.
Who's the Beatle?
Hang on, put me down!
I got him. Help me up.
He's my conscience. He tells me what's right and wrong.
What? You mean to tell me you take orders from a grasshopper?
Grasshopper? Look here, you impudent young pup.
And this sequence leads to probably the scariest moment in the film. The moment when Lampwick suddenly develops ears and Pinocchio's horror in watching it.
Then the tail comes out of Lampwick and Pinocchio and putting down the cigar. Key to that whole scene is Pinocchio himself. It's the reaction, not the action.
It's like a Hitchcock film, the way it's staged, the pacing of that, and the lighting in it.
What's going on?
It's building and building. Lampwick is freaking out.
And you cut to Pinocchio, and you see Pinocchio's horror, and you see Lampwick's hands pawing.
And we see him in silhouette, kicking at things in the room.
This guy who's so cocky and so confident turns into a whimpering little baby. It's chilling.
It's one of the most powerful pieces of cinema I've ever seen anywhere. It has nothing to do with whether it's animated or whether it's live action. That is perfect visual storytelling.
It would be tempting to say that Pinocchio is the pinnacle of Disney animation. This is a dynamic film in which acting, which is what animation is really about, acting with pencils and pens and ink and paint. It's where acting really takes off, and we see it in a way that had never been seen in animation before.
Well, as usual with Disney, I think the casting is perfect. He definitely would go through different people in auditions to get the voice that they were looking for every character.
Pinocchio had the best vocal performances of any of their features, I think. I love them.
Say, that's pretty swell.
Cliff Edwards, otherwise known as Ukulele Ike, is the voice and really the character of Jiminy Cricket in Pinocchio.
Cricket's the name. Jiminy Cricket.
Cliff Edwards was a great star in vaudeville, on Broadway, on records, on radio. He had a hit record in the 1920s of a song called June Night that some people say may have been the first million-selling record. He also, in one of the first talkie musicals, introduced the song Singing in the Rain, he and his little ukulele. He was known as Ukulele Ike.
Cliff Edwards was probably the first famous name ever to be cast in a cartoon. That wasn't done. I mean, today we have movies, you know, with John Travolta. you know, whoever in the voice cast. Back then, it was the people at the studio. Walt Disney himself was Mickey Mouse.
It's me, I guess.
Or they would hear a funny voice like Clarence Nash, who was Donald Duck.
Cliff Edwards had a wonderful, charming, lively voice, and it was because of that Jiminy took on a lot of the characteristics that he did, because Jiminy, of course, is singing songs in the film, and he's really almost like a Cliff Edwards surrogate.
An animator just kills for a voice like that. You know, you're dying to have someone with that kind of variation and melody to the voice and project such a likable quality. He's as good as you get.
Oh, yeah. Almost forgot about you.
Dickie Jones wasn't the first choice for the voice of Pinocchio, but when the character was redesigned, his voice seemed to go well, and according to Walt, he just had a typical nice boy's voice.
They started off with adults, and when Walt first heard the ones trying to act like kids, he said, no, I want a real little boy.
What are those?
They're your schoolmates, girls and boys.
Real boys?
Yes.
I think Dickie Jones as Pinocchio is spectacular. He's just unbelievably lovable and likable in his innocence.
Ooh, nice.
And his excitement about everything.
Oh, look, Father, look.
You just fall in love with that little guy the minute he starts talking.
I'm gonna be a real boy.
Dickie Jones had quite a year because he recorded Pinocchio in, I think, 1939. That's the same year he appeared in Destry Rides Again with James Stewart, and Frank Capra's Mr. Smith Goes to Washington with James Stewart. He was a busy young actor and a very good one.
The lady, the fairy.
Evelyn Venable was a perfect choice for the Blue Fairy, who is this idealized woman.
Well, I'll forgive you this once, but remember, a boy who won't be good might just as well be made of wood.
Evelyn Venable was an actress that you don't hear about too much these days, but she starts showing up in Hollywood films in about the mid-1930s. And of course, it was the quality of her voice that commended her for this character.
Good Geppetto, you have given so much happiness to others. You deserve to have your wish come true.
And Christian Rubb is just a phenomenally endearing Geppetto.
Now I have just a name for you, Pinocchio.
I hear they were having trouble designing the character until they found that the actor to do his voice, Christian Rubb. Not many people know he looks just like that.
He was actually the live physical model for the animators when they were working on Geppetto.
Christian Rubb is a very good actor and so genuine, sincere, in all his little off-cuff remarks to Pinocchio. No, Pinocchio.
Little funny face. Close your eyes and go to sleep.
He's so underplayed, you know. There's such a sweet underplay to it. But what I love about Geppetto is the way he's also kind of brutal. He kind of kicks the cat around, you know, takes the puppet and kicks the cat. Uh-oh, you know.
Up to mischief already.
Stromboli, the master showman. That's me.
Charles Judels, who played Stromboli, was a character actor. It was not exactly a household name, but who'd been in a lot of stage plays and a lot of movies, and who had this shtick of doing a kind of a whinny when he got excitable and upset. And he does that whinny as Stromboli.
He also did the coachman.
How would you blokes like to make some real money?
So he did an Italian and he did an Englishman. Good voice.
Actually, a funny story is that Mel Blanc, who is well known as the voice of Bugs Bunny, a man of 1,000 voices, who never worked for Disney, except he was the voice of Gideon, the cat, and they recorded lines with him, and then they decided later on, in a true Disney change of mind while they're making the film, to have Gideon be a mute character.
Remember, Gideon, the time I tied strings on you and passed you off as a puppet?
And in fact, he has one line in Pinocchio. It's, you know, one hiccup.
One of my favorite character actors plays Honest John, Walter Catlin, a wonderful and talented comedic actor who, again, had been on the stage in vaudeville, on Broadway, in lots and lots of movies.
Walter Catlett was a Shakespearean actor, and he really put on the dog. He was acting all the time. He was just a great guy. His part was just made for him.
With that personality, that profile, that physique,
why, he's a natural-born actor, eh, Kitty?
They also filmed him in live action, in costume, playing some of the activities that the fox would do in the film.
We must diagnose this case at once.
Rotoscoping was made for that purpose. Technically, rotoscoping is shooting live-action film and then tracing each frame onto animation paper. And then those drawings would be used as reference. And the point of it, of course, is that they're just using it for the suggestions of ideas that they can get from that. We have some wonderful live-action film that was shot at the time of Pinocchio featuring an actor named Val Stanton who would be costumed and would go through the movements that Jiminy Cricket would play in one of his scenes. It doesn't mean that they would be tracing every arm movement and leg movement that he did. What they'd be doing is looking at the whole general spirit of his movements and any ideas that he might unconsciously suggest.
What they can't do these days.
Pinocchio. Every time I think about it, I think how blessed I was that I was there at the right time, right moment. And I was the one that Walt Disney decided to use. And the people that I got to work with, it's unbelievable. I worked with some of the best character actors in the business at that time. I'm so proud that I was able to work with one of the greatest groups that was ever assembled for an animated feature.
To make Geppetto's wish come true will be entirely up to you.
Go on. Say something.
Gee, you're funny.
Very good. Why, I can see your name in lights. Lights 6 feet high.
Your face. She will be on everybody's tongue.
Will she?
Walt Disney was after one thing in the execution of Pinocchio. Perfection. And he would stop at nothing to achieve it. Snow White had turned out so well, but by the time they finished Snow White, at the end of that 4-year journey, they felt they'd learned so much that even they were embarrassed by some of the early work on the film.
I watched Pinocchio, and I think this is the one where they went, okay, now everything we couldn't do in Snow White, let's do in this one. Let's make this the most rich visual entertainment we could possibly make.
Very importantly, there was money available now, almost unlimited money, to pursue perfection in a way that hadn't been the case before.
Walt put pressure on you to make it better, whether he had a nickel in his pocket or $1 million. He worked harder than anybody, and he would drum his fingers on the chair, and he'd rub his chin and scowl and think, there's potential here, and we're not getting it.
During the late 30s, they had been aiming more and more toward a richer, deeper, darker look in their films, a more luxurious look. My friend Russell Merritt refers to it as the Rembrandt look. I think that look pretty much reaches its apex in Pinocchio. It is the most lavishly, beautifully mounted film they ever produced.
And that richness comes from the work of two men, one of whom was a man called Albert Herter, who was a Swiss artist who'd worked for Disney for some years and had been very influential on the creation of the style of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. And the other was an artist called Gustav Tengren, who was a Swedish artist.
Pinocchio is an Italian story, theoretically taking place in Italy, but it's a very sort of Germanic Italy, and a lot of it was designed by this Swedish artist. So you've got kind of a whole European community going here. And he had a lot to do with that great old world feeling and these wonderful atmospheric, quaint streets of the village that Geppetto lives in, things like that.
Tengren made wonderful paintings of things like the village and the interior of Geppetto's house. And they were turned into backgrounds by Claude Coates with the most appetizing appeal.
Albert Herter is the man responsible for probably almost all of those little touches, those little knickknacks that you see around Geppetto's workshop. The pipes with faces on, all of the little character touches, the fire dogs in the grate when Jiminy Cricket is warming himself by the coals. All of these rich little details were the work of Albert Herter.
He was a key person in designing the music boxes, the toys, the interior of Geppetto's workshop, giving it this look of a European storybook.
Everybody always remembers the cuckoo clocks. There was a great deal of imagination that went into those. The inspiration came from the sketches, but those cuckoo clocks actually were built and were functioning props, and the animators could actually watch how they worked. There really were all kinds of technical experiments going on all through the time that Pinocchio was being made, and especially in the camera effects department. There was a man named Hermann Schultheis who worked in the camera department then and did posterity an enormous favor by taking pictures of the camera setups that they used for some of these effects and documenting exactly how it was done.
The multiplane camera was a device that the Disney studio invented that gave depth to the animation scene. With this camera, they can do elaborate background paintings and go through the scene. And they did that frequently in this film.
The really standout scene is the beginning of sequence two, which is the morning in the village, where you've got that famous scene going over the rooftops. You've got not only depth moves, but also lateral moves. And in the end, what they did was do a variation on the multiplane, only instead of shooting down through that big crane, they shot it horizontally. And they had big frames holding these glass panes that were painted for this, only they were gigantic things. And the camera would move forward through those.
The use of models was also very important in this film.
There had been a very little bit of that on Snow White, but that practice really came into its own on Pinocchio. And in fact, the head of the model department was Joe Grant, and he was one of the legendary artists at the Disney studio.
He had to have something in the way of development, which turned out to be what we call the character model department. We weren't just making models, we were part of the story from the very beginning.
There was also a guy in the character model department named Bob Jones, who had been a professional puppeteer and who actually had come to the Disney studio hoping to convince Walt to make three-dimensional films, in effect, puppet films. Appropriately enough, he wound up working on Pinocchio. And he helped a good deal in forming these models that the animators used. And of course, the great advantage of that was that once the model was approved, then each of the animators who worked with that character could use one.
The coachman's coach that takes the kids to Pleasure Island was also a full-scale model.
There were also models of Stromboli's wagon. And actually, the model for Stromboli's wagon was used for more than just reference. What they did was build this actual physical wagon in miniature, but film it going through the same actions at the same angles that they needed for the film, and then blow up those frames and make wash-off relief cells from them. And then the actual animation of the characters was combined with that.
Pinocchio has an intensification of the sort of painstaking efforts that they'd already put into earlier films. There's a higher level of skill.
It just sparkles and glows, and part of that is because there were so many specialists working on it.
I definitely look at Pinocchio as being the pinnacle of effects animation. It set the standard. It set the bar.
Well, I would say effects at that time were so beautifully done. We still look back at it as one of the most perfect technical pictures we ever made.
When I started working here at Disney, one of the things I did early on was go over to the Animation Research Library. I used to take some of those scenes out. I'd spend hours looking and studying that animation, and it was just absolutely astounding. You have all these wavelets. You've got this surface tension that's moving. Then you add on top of that the actual final drawings where the waves closest to camera have thicker line work to them that gradually gets thinner as you go back on the drawing to help give it even more depth.
I've been going through the work diary of an effects animator named Sandy Strother, one of many who worked on the film. And he worked for over a year mainly on water effects, meaning the splashes and ripples and bubbles and foam and so on, plus the texture of the water itself. They experimented over and over with different ways of getting the depth in the water to look convincing.
They found an infinite number of ways to do scenes more elaborately than ever been done before. One of the effects animators, Ed Parks, said that for the water at the end of the film, what they would do is they'd have the cell, which would have the waves traced on it. They would actually shade the waves with mixtures of blue and black scriptal pencil lead, smoothing this onto the paper to create the sense of modeling of the waves and the play of the light on the waves. And this could take forever to do one of these.
Effects animation really is a supporting character in the film. In every picture, there's always been a sequence where the effects break out and have that sort of momentary starring role, whether it's the storm sequence in The Little Mermaid or in Pinocchio, it's that whole Monstro the Whale sequence, which is just stunning.
All the marvelous water in that whale chase, I think that was one of the finest sequences the studio has ever turned out, because the water is handled without so much logic in the way the waves work to make it entertaining. There's a big wave when you need it. When you don't need it, there's this smoother surface with a lot of wind blowing, a lot of wonderful foam on there. As Frank said once, the water's so believable, a person could drown in it. And then they do.
There was a crazy madman of a guy named Josh Metter, who was the effects animator on a lot of that Monstro sequence. If you look at the Monstro sequence, you think, oh yeah, well, so we're gonna do the sequence with a whale and he's gonna swallow our stars. But he's gonna jump around for a while and you wanna see a water splash? Well, great, we'll show you a water splash, but we'll show it to you from 3/4 of an angle and we'll have it splash up at the screen and we'll recreate nature and these wave crashes. The fearlessness of Pinocchio and the artistry is what impresses me. And Josh Metter was as much of a hero of Pinocchio as anyone else.
In the end, I think all of the technical devices and all of the accomplishments of technique that you see in the film are not there just as dry technical exercises. They add up to a film that seems to say that there is no limit to what can be done in a work of art. It seems to indicate boundless possibilities.
The element of Pinocchio that I think is maybe not fully appreciated is just the sounds in Pinocchio. The sounds of the clocks ticking and when they go off, all those little delightful, charming chimes and melodies within all the different clocks. It's a great sound.
We see a clock with ducks quacking. We see a clock with a tippler waving his bottle. We see a clock with a mama spanking her bad little boy. Each one has its own different sound. But it's layered so much that it becomes this sort of wonderful mechanical toy symphony.
Walt always had a way of doing things with sounds where you just can't even imagine how he came up with that sound, how those guys did it. Like, if you look at Monstro, how they came up with the sound of that whale. Inhaling. I don't know what causes that sound, but it is an incredible, terrifying sound that he came up with.
Actually, in the story meetings, they discussed doing new sounds, things that we hadn't heard before. I mean, they specifically were looking for something that would get people's attention because it was something they had not experienced in an earlier film. Whether it was using unusual percussion sounds, or in the case of the Blue Fairy, this would become sort of a trademark for magic, where you have strings and celesta being sort of the keyboard high bells, but also the use of a nova chord, which is a very, very early electronic piano that has a very ethereal, strange sound to it. It's the sound of magic. And films from this point on would very much look to that sound as sort of the standard.
I could listen to this whole movie without any visual at all and be completely transported to this sort of magical place and time. So it's a story in itself, just orally, to go through this film.
Pinocchio holds the distinction of being the first Disney feature to win Academy Awards for both musical categories, for Best Score and for Best Song, in this case, When You Wish Upon a Star. They would not receive those dual honors again until Mary Poppins, so this is quite some time, and then again in the late 80s, early 90s, with the Ashman and Mankin features, beginning with The Little Mermaid. So Pinocchio really sets a new bar for the kind of music that Disney was producing.
Originally, people thought that the musical score of Pinocchio wasn't nearly as good as Snow White. But in years hence, they realized that this is one of the greatest scores for a film that was ever made.
The main part of Pinocchio's score was written by Lee Harleen, who came to Disney in the early 1930s and scored a lot of the most musically complex of the silly symphonies, films like Music Land. And the band concert. And Grasshopper and the Ants. For Pinocchio, he really has his work cut out for him, because there are these songs that come up throughout the film, but there are far more dramatic moments in this film than anything else that Disney had done prior to this.
Bingo!
And if you listen to the range of styles that he uses in the film, charming, quaint music box kind of music in the early sequences in Geppetto's workshop is one thing.
A lot of downbeats in there.
You get to Pleasure Island, and you've got honky-tonks, kind of jazzy, bluesy music going on. You've got the music at the puppet show, where the song is sung by Pinocchio.
I got no strings to hold me down, to make me fret or make me frown.
And then taken through all of these international variations by all the other puppets in the show.
You have no strings, your arms is free. I've got strings, but aren't you new?
Fair me and I fun goes, but I'd rather go with you, eh?
The guy could cover practically any style of music. And it's easy to underestimate just what a magnificent score that is until you listen to the music by itself.
Hey! There are no strings on me.
Paul Smith also worked on the score for Pinocchio. He came to Disney in the mid-1930s, a few years after Lee Harleen, and he scored numerous Disney shorts. He's probably best remembered as having scored the True Life Adventure series in the 1950s, these live-action animal films that had a story to them. And the third person to work extensively on the score was Ned Washington. Now, Ned Washington was a lyricist, and he wrote the lyrics to some particularly famous songs, songs like Singin' in the Bathtub and Stella by Starlight. He would win an Academy Award not just for When You Wish Upon a Star and for the score, but he actually won another Academy Award for another song he wrote in 1952, that being the title song to High Noon, Do Not Forsake Me, Oh My Darling. So he really is someone who historically is very much associated with very popular songs.
Hi, diddle-dee-dee, a night is life for me. A high silk hat and a silver cane, a watch of gold with a diamond chain.
What's interesting about the score is it's not just songs. It is a through-composed piece, just extraordinarily orchestrated. And it's used ironically. And we don't expect that usually from animation films.
I hit string, but now I'm free. There are no strings on me.
When he's singing about his freedom, I've got no strings, we are aware that he has been entrapped by people that bear him no goodwill.
They got strings, but you can see there are no strings on me.
The animated cartoons, in particular, were really the first films that really the music and the songs not only were part of what the story was, but they actually moved the story along.
Who's afraid of the big bad wolf?
Big bad wolf, big bad wolf.
We have all grown up with many, many musicals, Broadway musicals, very famous things, but the classic Broadway musical that we know, that where the story is told through music, really started in the 40s.
In the development of the movie musical, from the time the talkies came along in the late 1920s through the 1930s, the great step forward, which was often credited to the Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers movies of that time, was making the songs part of the story. No one had thought of that before. And even on Broadway, that wasn't commonplace.
But really, it didn't take off until Oklahoma of the 1940s. But Disney was making Snow White and Pinocchio and even his Silly Symphony cartoons with music and songs that moved the films along with the songs and music before that. And it's really a precursor to it.
Walt just had a way or a vision that why waste time with a song? Why not have a song advance story?
Hey, that's good.
Now, most people know the music in Pinocchio mainly by way of When You Wish Upon a Star. That became kind of an anthem for the studio. But originally, the idea was you got Geppetto wishing that the puppet could become a real boy.
Wouldn't it be nice if he was a real boy?
And then somebody comes up with the idea of having him wish on a star, starlight, star bright, the way people have done sometimes. So the obvious thing is to have Harleen write a song about wishing on a star. That's all it was. But it, as we know, it became one of the best known songs in history.
Anything your heart desires will come.
When You Wish Upon a Star is a once-in-a-lifetime song. For Disney, it's the equivalent of Somewhere Over the Rainbow. And that kind of wishing song, that kind of dreams may come true song, is so unique to Disney.
Fate steps in and sees you through.
And sung by a cricket, which I always thought was amazing. You know, you would say, well, let's give that song to the beautiful young princess or the handsome. No, no, it's sung by a cricket wearing a tuxedo.
I don't think anybody could ever do it better than Cliff Edwards did. There's been several top-notch vocalists that tried it. They come close, but not quite.
If your heart is in your dream, no request is too extreme.
And what the song speaks of is hope, affirmation. It speaks of a belief in dreams. And interestingly, it has gone on speaking to people in exactly the same way, so that it became the song which represented Disney. This became Disney's anthem.
When Pinocchio was first released, there was a great deal of anticipation.
Oh yes, Pinocchio, my boy.
The reviews, when it first opened, you see the critics just falling over themselves, trying to come up with new superlatives to convey the idea that this is an even better film than Snow White.
Oh, that's nothing.
But then an odd thing happened, and it wasn't very successful at the box office.
I'll bet a lot of you folks don't believe that.
The explanation that you usually hear is that the European market was being cut off because of the war, and that was a factor.
It cost almost twice as much as Snow White, and yet it was not the success that Snow White was.
Please, Your Honor, Miss Ferry? Give him another chance, for my sake, will you?
Now, of course, we look back and realize what a major achievement the film was.
Twenty years before Pinocchio, you were looking at stick figures and rubber hose princesses and these little vaudevillian Mickey Mouses wandering around the screen in black and white, drawn with a quarter and two nickels. It was a really primitive art form, and these guys moved the art form ahead to Pinocchio. I mean, that's a big journey, and that's why we stand on their shoulders, because they were the guys that brought the art form together.
Just everybody on that crew who worked on the film gave it all they've got. There isn't a movie like it. There probably never will be a movie like it. It's just a masterpiece.
These cards were a celebration.
My kids, then my grandkids, now my great-grandkids, they're still playing it. That's four decades. Pinocchio's gonna go on forever.
They like it. He's a success.